Well, good evening. Welcome to Faith Community Church. We're glad you've joined us tonight. I'm excited to worship with each one of you. Before we start, just a few things. We won't pass offering baskets within the service tonight, but they are available at the door if you'd like to contribute to the offering. If you're a visitor with us tonight, you're under no obligation to give to that. It's for our members and our regular attenders mostly, but we would love for everyone that's here to fill out a friendship register. That's the black book in your row at some point during the service tonight. You just jot down your name. Please share any prayer requests or praises that are on your mind tonight. We'd love to be praying for that as a church. And so, like I said earlier, we're excited to worship together. I invite you to stand if you're able and join us as we do just that.
To the ending of the day, one name alone be praised. As every nation, tribe, and tongue, all creation lifting up, your name alone we raise. Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth. Bless His name, only one name, now and always. Jesus, you have rescued us. You are good and you are just. The heights and from the depths, in every heart with every breath, your name alone we raise. Praise the Lord, all the earth, all the earth.
Hills,
Where does my help come from? From you, you alone. You're reaching out for me. You are my Savior.
and the church sings back.
We thank you for the great truth, even that we just celebrated last week, that you are victorious over the grave. And the hope that that gives us, knowing that we can trust in Jesus to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We thank you for that great gift. We thank you for that great message. And Lord, we look forward to spending eternity praising your name. Just as now around the throne there is praise being shouted. Lord, we pray even that you might hasten that day. Come soon, Lord Jesus. And if you don't, we trust you, we love you, and we're going to keep on praising you here for as long as you've given us here on earth. Thanks for your love. We pray now as we open your word together. First of all, we thank you for the great gift of your word, which still speaks to us today. And we pray that your spirit might grant us understanding as we open it together tonight, that we might leave here changed as a result of having interacted with your word and thus interacting with you. And we pray this in the powerful name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Everybody have a good Resurrection Day last Sunday? Great. Anybody have a terrible one? There's a verse we covered in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12. It says, all things are lawful for me, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. We're going back in our study to 1 Corinthians chapter 8. We're going to be looking at a new problem. It's called the problem of liberty, the problem of our freedom in Christ. Paul starts off this chapter 8. By the way, if you don't have a Bible, please grab one in front of you and turn to the New Testament, which is to the back of the Bible, to page 134, and you'll find 1 Corinthians chapter 8. He starts off with this phrase, now concerning. Ever since chapter 7, he wrote, now concerning the things about which you wrote. In other words, the people at this church in Corinth wrote him a letter and says to him, Paul, would you address some of these issues? And so the first one he mentions in chapter 7, verse 1, is about marriage. And now he's going to address a new one in chapter 8 concerning the things sacrificed to idols. Now we just learned all things are lawful for me. Now when you think of things that are lawful, what are the things that are always right for a Christian to do? Okay, if you were going to make a list, what is it always right for a Christian to do? And then what is always wrong for a Christian to do? And if you wrote a list of all the right things and then all the wrong things of a Christian, and then we traded papers and we just saw, what did you write? What did I write? Do you think we'd agree on everything? No, we wouldn't agree on everything. Some of them we would agree on, like it's always wrong to murder. Probably you all would have that down. What's always right? And sometimes when we look at lists, I would look at Mike Mulvaney's list, and I'd see that, ooh, he thinks this is always wrong, but I do it all the time. And there might be something on my list that you think is absolutely right that I think is wrong. So we call those things gray areas. Gray areas. Everything's not so black and white. For instance, let's just talk about one product called tobacco. Okay? Christians differ on this. I grew up in a Baptist church. Not Southern Baptist, where they may do a lot of smoking, but Northern Baptist, and for us, smoking was, no, Christians did not smoke. You don't smoke cigarettes or cigars, maybe a pipe. Others would say, nope, cigarettes, cigars, and pipe are all wrong, but it's okay if you play baseball and you chew tobacco. Another would say, no, actually, all of it's okay. The Bible's not condemning tobacco products. And so we would have disagreements. Some of you might have, yeah, smoking's on my list, always wrong. Some of you would have on the list, always right. So how do we use this liberty? How do we know how we should use the freedom we have in Christ? Because aren't we free in Jesus Christ? It was for freedom that Christ came to set you free. He did not come to set you free to just keep a whole bunch of rules. That's not why Christ set us free, that we would be rule-based. And so he's going to spend a whole chapter. Now, last week we had a long chapter, chapter 15. I was going to cover the rest of it today, and I realized that's too many verses. I can't do that in one Sunday. So I'm going to have to make that a whole series, resurrection chapter 15. So I told Greg late in the week, maybe Wednesday or so, that I'm going to go back to chapter 8, which is only 13 verses. So he only put four songs in, thinking I was going to go really long. And I'm not going to go really long because it's only 13 verses, so you're going to get out of here way before 7 o'clock. And you're all thinking, praise the Lord. I wish all chapters were 13 verses. Well, let's talk about this problem of liberty. Are you there at the text? Are you there? 1 Corinthians chapter 8. Now concerning things sacrificed to idols, it's not a problem we have today. Concerning things sacrificed to idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge makes arrogant or puffs up, but love edifies. If anyone supposes that he knows anything, he has not yet known as he ought to know. But if anyone loves God, he is known by him. Therefore, concerning the eating of things sacrificed to idols, we know that there is no such thing as an idol in the world and that there is no God but one. For even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords, yet for us, meaning the Christian, the believer, there is but one God, the Father, from whom are all things and we exist for him, and one Lord. Who's that? Jesus Christ. By whom are all things, and we exist through him. However, not all men have this knowledge, but some, being accustomed to the idol until now, eat food as if it were sacrificed to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. But food will not commend us to God. We are neither the worse if we do not eat, nor the better if we do eat. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if someone sees you who have knowledge dining in an idol's temple, will not his conscience, if he is weak, be strengthened to eat things sacrificed to idols? For through your knowledge, he who is weak is ruined, the brother for whose sake Christ died. And so by sinning against the brethren, wounding their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food causes my brother to stumble, I will never eat meat again, so that I will not cause my brother to stumble. All right, before we look at this a little closer, let's pray. Lord, give us insight, wisdom. What is this talk about food sacrificed to idols, and what does that mean possibly for us today? And so teach us through the word of God. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Paul, believe it or not, will spend three chapters dealing with this issue of freedom or liberty. This chapter, I just read it, so you know it's talking about liberty. It says, take care that this liberty of yours does not become a stumbling block to the weak. If you look at chapter 9, he talks about liberty in his own life. Am I not free? And then in chapter 10, he's also speaking about liberty when you look down in verse 29, where he says, I mean not your own conscience, but the other man's. For why is my freedom judged by another's conscience? So he's talking through these three chapters about this issue dealing with liberty, your freedom that you have in Jesus Christ. How can you use this freedom in an appropriate way? So for three chapters, chapter 9 is going to be more of a personal, Paul's personal life with regard to liberty, and then he's going to look at Israel's mistakes in using liberty, and finally sum up the whole thing with that verse in verse 23 of chapter 10, which is like the key verse, all things are lawful, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful, but not all things edify. Not everything builds up. So knowing these three chapters all deal with liberty, let's look at chapter 8. He's talking about things that are sacrificed to idols. In verse 28, this is meat sacrificed to idols, he says in chapter 10, verse 28. So the issue is idolatry a sin? Yes or no? All Christians would agree idolatry is a sin. Going to a temple to worship an idol would be a sin. Now the question comes, can a Christian eat meat that was once sacrificed to an idol? Now we're in a gray area. Can a Christian eat meat that was once sacrificed to an idol? Or let's reword it this way. Can a Christian eat meat that was sacrificed to an idol in the idol's temple? Well, let me show you what a temple in Corinth looked like back in that day. In this figure, you can see that, let's look at the top part. I have now a pen that works on the screen. Isn't that cool? Okay, so I don't need you back there anymore. Okay, so they're coming to the temple, they come in here, and if they want to worship this idol, they go into the temple proper. Here's the altar. They put their meat on this altar, it would get burned up, and they take some of the good roasted meat and then serve it. Now, this is called an oblation, a baton. I think it's a clinical place for people to get healed, because this is a temple to Asclepius. And so it's a healing place. But underneath this, you see, what's this called? Dining rooms. So the next picture you can see is now the ground floor. And there's a courtyard, but you can see that there are three different dining rooms. And each one of these dining rooms is a place for them to cook meals and to serve the meat that had been sacrificed to an idol. It's like going to a fancy restaurant that just happened to be in the temple district. The temple is made of very costly material, nice gold and stones and precious things. And the eating there, it's like you're going to a five-star restaurant. Can a Christian not have anything to do with the temple and the idols, but just go eat a meal there? Can one? I'm not going to answer that yet. Let's change the scenario a little bit. Suppose you're a new Christian and you've been invited to a non-Christian's house, and this non-believer who you want to reach for Jesus Christ invites you to eat. Now, this non-believer went down to the local food store called the Meat Market in the plaza and found out that the meat that was once laying before this dumb idol is now on sale. It's half price. And because it had laid there for a little bit, so now they cooked it and they bring it here, and now this person buys the food and then serves it to you. Can you as a Christian eat in the non-Christian's house the meat that is served there, knowing that it came from an idol? Well, let's change the scenario again. Suppose your spouse goes down to the meat market and sees a great deal on this meat, of meat that was sacrificed to an idol one time, and says, you know, as a Christian, I got to give my money to the Lord, and I got to use my money wisely, and I got to really not be wasteful with the money that the Lord has provided. So after all, meat is meat. And therefore, I'm going to buy that piece of steak there and bring it home and cook it up for the family, and we're going to eat tonight. Can you eat the meat that was once sacrificed to an idol? Okay. Now, Christians all over the spectrum would say yes to one of those, and maybe not to the others, or maybe none of them would be acceptable. But that's the issue that was in Paul's day. So what is he going to say? Let's look at the guidelines for Christians when it comes to those gray areas. The first thing he tells us in verses, I think, 1 through 8, is that knowledge should take a backseat to love. Love supersedes knowledge. And in verses 1 through 3, he gives us a contrast between knowledge and love. Now, concerning the things sacrificed to idols, we know that all have knowledge, all have some kind of information about this. And he says knowledge does what? Knowledge puffs up. Knowledge makes one arrogant. After all, I know something that you might not know. It gives you a feeling of superiority in the fact that you know something. But he goes on to say, love is what edifies. It's a contrast. Love makes you arrogant, but love builds another up when you exercise love. Paul goes on to say, even those in the Corinthian who are Christians in the Corinthian church who think they know it all. You know, if you know anything, they think they know the know-it-alls. Any know-it-alls here? Don't point at me. Any other know-it-alls? What Paul is trying to tell us here is, you really don't know all you think you know. And he'll point out later in this chapter what they don't know. He goes on to say in verse 2, if anyone supposes that he knows anything, well, he doesn't yet know as he ought to know. But if anyone, notice the contrast, if anyone knows, and now if anyone loves God. What does it mean to love God? It means to put him first. It means to serve him. Well, this one is now known by God. So the important issue is not that we have knowledge, not that we even know God, but that we love God and that we are known by him. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, nevertheless, the firm foundation of God stands, having this seal, the Lord knows those who are his. The Lord knows those who are his. So if anyone loves God, well, then the Lord knows that one. See, love builds up. Knowledge doesn't build up. Love does. Love, not knowledge, is our guide. It's not that we know God. It's does he know you? So the first thing is he makes a contrast between knowledge and love. In verses 4 through 6, now he's going to give us some knowledge about idols. It's a theological argument here. Let's talk about these idols. The Christian, when you consider the things that are sacrificed idols, first of all, we know, Christians know, that there is no such thing as an idol in the world. What does that mean? There's no such thing as an idol. Well, we know that idols were either wood, stone, metal, but it's just a figure that sits there. Isaiah has some good arguments about why do you bow down before something that can't see, hear, or act, or do anything? I mean, why are you doing that? Because an idol is nothing. And Christians know there's no such thing as an idol. That's not a god. But Christians do know what? They do know that there is no god but one. Remember the verses, the verse in Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 5. It's called the Shema passage in Israel. It goes, hear, that's the word Shema, hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And when Jesus was asked, you know, what's the greatest commandment? Where does he go? He goes right here. The greatest commandment is you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Isaiah 45, verses 5 and 6. The prophet writes, the Lord speaking, I am Yahweh, I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I will gird you, though you have not known me. The men may know from the rising to the setting of the sun that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. How many gods are there in this world? One. It's the Lord God. And so what he's writing here, Paul's saying, we know that there's no God but one. This idol is nothing. And so he goes on to say, now the pagans, however, they worship these so-called gods. I like the so-called gods. Paul says, even if there are these so-called gods. Now, do the Romans and Greeks have a lot of gods? Oh, tons of gods. They have gods for everything. And so they had many gods and many lords, and that's what he's saying here. So let's even assume that they're there. Even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as indeed there are many gods and many lords in their thinking, yet for us, who's the us? The believer. Yet for us, there is but one God, the Father. And we exist for him or are for him, and one Lord, who is Jesus Christ. So it's a contrast between verses 5 and 6. Many gods, many lords, that's what they believe. We believe there is one God and one Lord, and his name is Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we exist through him. So he's given us knowledge about these idols. They're really nothing. They're not God. Now, when he gets to verse 7, he tells us, however, not all men have this knowledge. Now, the men here are Christians. Not all Christians have this knowledge. But some, being accustomed to the idol until now, meaning until they came to Christ, well, they eat the food as if it were sacrificed to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. So he says, not all men have this knowledge. All Christians don't have this knowledge of verses 4 through 6 yet because they're new believers in Christ. As a new believer in Christ, they've been accustomed to what idol worship is. They went to the temple, they walked up, they brought their sacrifice to the temple, it was burnt up, they took the meat off, and then they would go dine on it. So their idea of temple worship is sacrifice to the idol and then eat at the temple while you're there. And so for them, when it comes to food sacrificed to idols, they just can't eat it. It brings back too many memories of what they did in paganism. And now they belong to Jesus Christ. He's my Lord and Savior. And I just cannot go into the temple to eat meat. See, these new believers, they still think of the meat as the idol's food. And to eat that meat, to eat for them, is now to still participate in some kind of worship of that idol. And if they were to eat that meat, it would affect their conscience because it's called weak. It's not strong yet, and they're defiling their conscience. And so in verse 8, Paul says, let me tell you about this food. Let me tell you about this meat that you're going to eat. Meat, the food, will not commend us to God, meaning that the food will not bring us any nearer to God. This food will not make us more acceptable to God. It doesn't matter if we eat it or don't eat it. We're not worse if we do not eat it. We're not better if we do eat. Because the food itself doesn't bring us at all closer to God. It has nothing to do about the food. Now, Warren Wiersbe, in his commentary, he states a few reasons why Christians may have weak consciences. Now, when he says conscience, he means that internal court where our actions are now judged as being either right actions or wrong actions. There's this internal thing inside of us, he calls it a court, where the actions are judged as either right or wrong. And he says that our consciences are strengthened by spiritual knowledge. The more we learn God's word, the more that we understand God's word, the stronger our consciences will become. The less we know about God's word, the weaker our consciences will be. And so he says there are three reasons why one would have a weak conscience as a believer in Christ. One, is that the Christian is newly saved. They're just born again. They haven't had time to grow in Christ yet. They're still babes in Christ. Another reason why somebody might have a weak conscience is that they choose not to grow. In other words, they're a believer, but they ignore the Bible, they ignore God's word, they ignore fellowshipping together with other believers, they're not involved in any kind of what we call life groups. They're not around other believers to grow. And so they're choosing not to grow. And when you choose not to grow, you stay as a babe in Christ, an infant in Christ, and you're still fleshly, is what he said in chapter 3. You just refuse to grow in Christ. You'll still have a weak conscience. And thirdly, he says there's also the Christian who remains weak because they're afraid of stepping out in freedom. They have the freedom in Christ, but they're fearful of using that freedom that God provides us. So he says three reasons why one might have a weak conscience. Now, the rest of this chapter, Paul first says, the first guideline is knowledge takes a back seat to love. Love will trump knowledge. And secondly, the one who has a strong conscience takes a back seat to the one who has a weak conscience. He says in verse 9, take care. Take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. The one that has the weak conscience. He says your liberty here means your right. You have the right to do something according to the word of God. You've got a right to it. You have authority to do something. But he says take care that you don't use your rights and your authority, which would then cause someone to stumble. Because obviously you're not acting in love when you do that, correct? And then he gives an illustration in verse 10. If someone, meaning someone that's got more of a weak conscience, if someone sees you, you who have knowledge, meaning you have the knowledge that, look, idols are nothing. It's a great atmosphere to eat in that fancy restaurant. The meat is good. You have the knowledge to do that. It's not sin for you. He says, if you have the knowledge, and this one who doesn't have the knowledge, doesn't have verses 4 through 6 planted in their brain, then they see you dining in an idol's temple. Well, will not his conscience, if it is weak, now be strengthened to eat things sacrificed to idols? So at one point they're saying, I'm not going to do it, but now I can go in there because I see my spiritual brother going in there and eating in there. And so if it's okay for him, it's okay for me, but when they go in there and eat, something happens internally to them. They feel guilty. They're doing something wrong. They remember all the times that they used to go into the temple and do that same kind of eating, but they were worshiping the pagan idol, and now even though they're worshiping the Lord God, they feel tremendous guilt going in there. And so Paul is saying in verse 11, you're ruining your brother. He's feeling this tremendous guilt. He feels as if he's sinning by eating that meat that was once offered up to an idol. And that ruin word is really, it's like destructive to, it's destroying his faith, is what Paul is saying. And so what he's going to tell us in verses 11 and 12, that flaunting your liberty at your weaker brother's expense is wrong. And he gives us three reasons. He says, for through your knowledge, he who is weak is ruined. The brother for whose sake Christ died is ruined. It means you've caused him to really stumble. Remember he says, don't put a stumbling block there, but you're causing him to stumble, to fall into sin. You caused the weaker brother to stumble. And remember, don't forget, Christ died for that brother of yours. And the second reason why it's wrong, he says, and so in verse 12, and so by sinning against the brethren and wounding their conscience when it is weak. So he's saying, you've actually sinned against all your brothers and sisters who have a weak conscience. Not just that one brother, but all of them who are still growing in their faith. He says, you've wounded them. And thirdly, he says, you know, when you're wounding your weaker brother and sister in Christ, you're actually sinning against who? You're sinning against Jesus Christ. Saul knows this personally because when he had his conversion, remember, he was going to Damascus to round up the saints to put them in prison. And on the way to Damascus, all of a sudden, this bright light shines. He falls off his horse and he falls to the ground. And it says in Acts 9, verse 4, and he, meaning Saul, fell to the ground. He heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul said, who are you, Lord? And Jesus said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. So when Saul was persecuting brothers and sisters in Christ, it's the same as persecuting who? Jesus Christ. And Paul says here now in 1 Corinthians 8, when you are causing a brother who is young in the Lord, who doesn't have a strong conscience yet because he doesn't know the word of God yet, and when you're causing them to go into the temple to eat and they feel so guilty, you're causing him to fall and to stumble, and when you're wounding your weaker brother, you're sinning really against Jesus Christ. And so Paul ends up with the principle. Therefore, if food causes my brother to stumble, I will never eat meat again. That's hyperbole, okay? It means I'll never eat a touch of meat. I won't eat hamburger anymore. But the principle is so that I will not cause my brother to stumble. I don't want to cause my brother to stumble. If the exercise of something that's right for me, I have freedom to do it in Christ, I can do something by faith, and yet if I do this and it causes my brother or sister to fall into sin because they cannot do it by faith, then I must avoid this freedom until their conscience is strengthened. As one who is free in Christ, one with a strong conscience, we must take care that we don't tempt a weaker Christian to run ahead of their conscience. It hasn't grown yet. They don't have the discernment between what's right and wrong for them. Love trumps knowledge. But also, love seeks to help the brother or sister with a weaker conscience to grow in spiritual knowledge. See, love doesn't leave that person in that weaker condition, that weaker state. Love really helps that brother and sister to understand the freedoms that we do have in Christ. But that only comes when the Holy Spirit takes this word of God and now starts to open their minds and hearts with regard to what it says. And as they grow in their faith, they will then experience a greater amount of freedom, of liberty. But there's no excuse for a believer who's been a believer for many years to stay immature in their faith. The longer you walk with Jesus Christ, the more you should understand the amount of liberty we do have, the freedom we do have in Christ. The Christian life is not based on a set of rules. Some things are always wrong. What we've covered already, that's always wrong. Sexual immorality, is that always wrong? Always wrong. Murder, theft, idolatry. There are some things that are always wrong. Some things are always right. Loving God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Loving your neighbor as you love yourself. Loving other believers, which is the commandment that Christ Jesus gave. The world will know you're my disciples by your love for one another. Those things are always right. Being kind, tenderhearted, forgiving one another because God in Christ has forgiven you. Is forgiving other people always the right thing to do? Always the right thing to do. But there are some things that some Christians can do because they can do them by faith, while others who do not have that faith yet, or that amount of faith yet, cannot do those things. In these cases, remember, knowledge takes a backseat to love. And the one with the strong conscience takes a back seat to the one with a weaker conscience. And why? Because I will not cause my brother to stumble. Now let's talk about food sacrificed to idols. Does that really apply to us today? No. So what are the gray areas in Christian world? Leave tobacco out. I mentioned that already. Come on.
Drinking,
alcohol, okay? For some, they have a strong conviction that all alcohol is wrong. Does the Bible say all alcohol is bad? No, it doesn't. But it does say that we shouldn't get drunk to losing control, dissipation. We should be filled with the Holy Spirit instead. So yeah, drinking to drunkenness is always wrong, and drunkenness is one of the things that he condemns as one of the deeds of the flesh, works of the flesh. So obviously, in Galatians chapter 5, 17 through 19, drunkenness is one of the things that are always wrong for a Christian. But drinking. Now, we don't go to temples, to the restaurants there, but can I have the freedom to eat and drink at a bar? There's liberty here. There's freedom here. For some, the answer is?
Yes.
For others, the answer is?
No.
So how do I apply this principle of chapter 8 to that situation? Well, I got to keep in mind who might be the weaker brother or sister. When I'm thinking that through, and I'm thinking, you know, a person, a new believer in Christ, who has battled alcohol before coming to Christ, alcohol was a big, strong addiction to them, a bondage to them. My flaunting my liberty to go to a bar because they make great hamburgers, and having a beer with my hamburger, I could cause that brother of mine to say, look, if the pastor or anybody, I think Christian does it, if the spiritual one can do that, then I guess I can do that too. And as a new believer in Christ who's gotten away from alcohol, now goes in there, and well, it's only one beer, and so he takes that one beer, can I be leading him down a bad path?
Absolutely.
I caused him to stumble. And so it would be wrong for me to dine in a bar if it strengthens a new believer in Christ or one who came out of alcoholism that gives them the idea that they can go into that situation when they can't. I'm causing them to stumble. So although I have the freedom to eat and drink there because of that brother of mine, I will not. Right? Do I have the freedom to eat at a casino? Why do you bring that up? Well, because sometimes the meals are cheap at a casino. You know why they're cheap and it's good food? Because once you walk into the building, they think they got you. Because when you walk into the building, all of a sudden you hear these things going ding, 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 ding. And you're thinking to yourself, everyone's winning. So do I have freedom to go eat at the casino? I mean, do Christians have liberty to do that? I mean, it's good food at a great price. Well, I got to ask myself a question. Who might be my weaker brother or sister? Do people struggle with gambling addictions in the church? It'd be wrong for me to have them see me boasting that I went to eat at a casino. And by the way, I played a few slots and I won. Because that just might strengthen them to what? Go in there to eat, supposedly just to eat. I only play a couple slots. But those with the addiction, what happens? They go through all their money and then they take their credit card out and they get more money and they go... further and further into a hole. I've caused my brother who's got a problem in that area to what? Stumbling. For me, if I have faith to go into a casino, even play, I'm going to go into a movie with two people. It cost me $20. I'm just going to use $20 of my money to play the slots. And it's entertainment for me. Am I wrong in doing that? No. For me, it's a faith issue that doesn't affect my faith. I know I'm not going to use my life savings. Cheryl's making sure I'm not going to use my life savings. Keep that credit card in your pocket. Right? I have freedom because I have faith. I know that it's not going to take control of my life. But, you know, I can't guarantee that people I minister to, that they who are struggling in that area, when they hear that, they could fall. There's a whole lot of issues that we could deal with this gray area, right? Remember the movie Chariots of Fire when it came out? Eric Little. What could he not do? He could not run on Sunday, because for him, that was the Lord's day. It was his Sabbath day. And so he wouldn't run. Do Christians have liberty to play sports on Sunday? What about going to attend a sporting event on a Sunday? But what about if you got free tickets to the Cubs game that starts at 1 o'clock and you could not get to church on Sunday and we don't have the Saturday service anymore? We have liberty to do this, but is it possible that I could cause a weaker brother or sister to stumble because I'm putting sports over church? Oh, think of children. They're kind of weak in the faith. They don't know a lot about the faith, but they do know that mom and dad say church is a priority, but when it comes to sports, that trumps it. They grow up thinking church is optional. I guess when I'm not doing anything else, I guess I go to church. Are we hurting the weaker brother in the faith? Yes. What about I love dancing? Is it wrong for a Christian to go to a club dancing? For some, the answer is yes. For others, the answer is no. What's the liberty guidelines? Always know that your knowledge, your right to something, that takes a backseat to loving another believer in Christ. Always takes a backseat. Love trumps my knowledge. And the one with a strong conscience takes a back seat to the one with a weak conscience. Now, let me make the stipulation. If the one that has a weak conscience is because they're refusing to grow in Christ, I don't think you submit your strong conscience to a brother or sister who refuses to grow in Christ. I think Paul has in mind here that new believer whose conscience has not been built yet. Let's close by turning to Romans chapter 14. Very similar chapter to chapter 8 of 1 Corinthians. Look at verse 1. Now accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. One person has faith that he may eat all things, even squid. But he who is weak eats vegetables only, meaning meat is wrong. The one who eats is not to regard with contempt the one who does not eat, and the one who does not eat is not to judge the one who eats, for God has accepted him. Skip down to verse 13. He continues this with a therefore. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather determine this, not to put an obstacle or a stumbling block in a brother's way. I know, Paul's writing, I know and am convinced in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself. But to him who thinks anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. For if because of food your brother is hurt, you are no longer walking according to love. Do not destroy with your food him for whom Christ died. Therefore, do not let what is for you a good thing be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. It's not about eating and drinking. What is it about? It's about righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. For he who in this way serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then, we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another, right? Love edifies, love builds up. Do not tear down the work of God over food, for the sake of food. All things indeed are clean, but they are evil for the man who eats and gives offense. It is good not to eat meat or to drink wine or do anything by which your brother stumbles. The faith which you have as your own conviction before God. Happy is he who does not condemn himself in what he approves. But he who doubts is condemned if he eats, because his eating is not from faith. And whatever is not from faith is sin. If a person has in their conviction, has in their mind that anything alcoholic is wrong for me, then it is wrong for them. You understand that? It's wrong for them. But if it's not wrong for you and you have the faith, Paul is saying, happy is the one who doesn't condemn himself in what is approved. But I can't take something that's approved for me and flaunt it in front of a person who has that kind of a conviction causing them to stumble, because then I am sinning. Are we pretty clear on this? Okay, my job is done. And Greg, I did take the whole time. He says, you say you're going to make it short, but you never do, Bob. And then tomorrow, because I just went through this one, I'm going to add more stuff even tomorrow. Lord, we do come before you, and we thank you that Paul's being very honest over a situation that in Christ Jesus we have freedom in many areas. Help us never to use our freedom in such a way that will cause a brother or sister who is new in the faith to fall, to be a stumbling block, to be an obstacle in their growth in Christ. May we focus on this word called love, that we would love our brother, that we would do things to build that one, that sister up. And sometimes it means that we have to give them spiritual knowledge of the word of God so they understand that maybe an opinion, maybe a conviction that they held is really not a biblical conviction. And through the work of the Holy Spirit, they can have their consciences get stronger. So, Lord, help us to make sure that knowledge takes a backseat to love, and to make sure that we who are stronger in the faith, we take a backseat to the new believer in Christ Jesus who is working on their weaker conscience. For the sake of love, we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Well, I invite you to stand once more with us if you're able and join us as we close.
How great thou art, and when I think
Great God. Have a great week in Him this week, and we hope to see you back next week. Have a good one.